演讲题目是 Number Two， 计时开始。
As we live in this interrelated global village, it is getting increasingly necessary to be connected to the world. Today, there are three popular options for engaging in the world, which are studying on exchange, international volunteering opportunities, and working holidays. To participate in each of these three programs, students can go for public and private sectors that provide opportunities for young international adventure seekers like us. Further on, my teammate Yixing will address the first way, going on exchange as students.
Yes, thank you, Carol. Overseas Student Exchange Program offers students a chance to embark on an international venture. Student exchange will learn to appreciate and embrace the cultural differences by making foreign friends and get a better understanding of the world by approaching global issues in class. Thus, they develop a global perspective. Besides, just as the saying goes, exchange is not a year in a life, but a life in a year. One of the most notable changes in return exchange student is self-development, which in turn leads to enhanced self-confidence and self-esteem. Many public and private entities that provide students a chance to engage in international activities, such as the Rotary, EF, YFU, and EUSA. The Youth Administration Development, YDA, of the Ministry of Education also arrange study abroad courses, international conferences, and exchange programs. Earlier this year, I just came back from an exchange implemented by Rotary. During 1 year on exchange in Colorado, I not only sharpened my English skill, but also get a better understanding of the American culture. That was indeed a life-changing experience for me. Next, my teammate Laurie will elaborate on international volunteering program.
Yes, thank you, Yixing. International volunteering provides youngsters a chance to go abroad and engage in international affairs. In most cases, volunteers assist in helping the education, health, sanitation, and construction of the people in a given country. Volunteers don't usually have the technical skills or resources needed to create lasting changes in the community. But the learning that occurs during a volunteer experience can indeed be a part of a lifelong transformation. Students can gain confidence by accomplishing new things and build a real sense of achievement by doing volunteer work. There are several private sectors that provide international volunteering programs. For instance, Vision Youth Action, founded in 2002, has been successful in setting up a regional youth volunteer center by matching volunteers' preferences with regions in different countries to promote a short-term community service. Similarly, the Overseas Youth English Teaching Volunteer Service Program aims to help needy children in remote schools that lack resources, which can in turn boost volunteers' confidence in learning English. And next, my teammate Holly will share her views on how youth can enhance international engagement.
Thank you, Laurie. Lastly, working holidays are a favorite choice for youths who want to experience living or working in a foreign country without spending a lot of money. The YDA and the Ministry of Education has provided a loan project for youths who want to travel, study, or get holiday work overseas. Along with the loan project, Taiwan has signed working holiday visa agreements with 15 countries, including New Zealand, Australia, Japan, England, France, and so on. It enables young people from both countries to gain a deeper understanding of the other country's cultural traditions, and the diplomatic ties between the two countries will be improved. Also, they can improve their views of the world and get them a better perspective on their lives. Therefore, working holidays aren't just a way for youths to earn money while going on holiday. It is also a way to engage international, enhance in engagements. And finally, my teammate Carol will sum up the speech for you.
Thank you, Holly. One of my friends just came back from Cambodia on a project that ELIV planned. She helped deliver books to schools in remote areas and studied with the kids there, which she described as an enriching and meaningful experience that got her to realize how fortunate she was to have access to education. These three programs, international exchange programs, international volunteering opportunities, and working holidays organized by the government and private sectors, not only provide opportunities for youths to grow up as adults, but also to learn to solve real life issues. To become promising youths with a global vision, We should seize each opportunity, which will transform us into real global citizens for sure. And that brings us to the end of our speech. Thank you very much.
Number 2, 计时开始。
Good morning, dear judges, ladies and gentlemen. During the 1950s, GRC was the beneficiary of approximately $100 million in foreign aid each year, equivalent to almost one-tenth of its gross domestic product at that time. Through that assistance, the country was able to come through the difficult post-war years, bringing something of an economic miracle. Taiwan is, of course, grateful for that generosity and feels morally obligated to help other countries facing similar difficulties of our own. Over the past five decades, DRC has provided millions of dollars in financial aid as well as material, medical, and technical assistance abroad. The International Cooperation Development Fund, also known as Taiwan ICDF, has been pivotal in implementing government-funded foreign aid programs. In 2013, the organization implemented 92 projects in partner countries, principally in Latin America, the Caribbean, Africa, and Oceania.
There are a number of specific Taiwan-based non-governmental organizations, also known as NGOs, that have provided international assistance. Over the past several decades, a number of Taiwanese NGOs have provided humanitarian assistance, many of them working on projects closely aligned with the goals of the UN Millennium Development Program. Such work has been in collaboration with internationally renowned NGOs, such as the Border Consortia in France Sans Frontier, the Fullness Increased Fellowship in Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, and Pakistan. These works that brought Taiwanese NGOs into assisting in areas as diverse as agriculture, public health, and education. In Africa, Taiwan NGOs have implemented educational and medical projects in Swaziland and Malawi. In South America, some NGOs have cooperated with the Christian Children's Fund and World Vision in Paraguay, El Salvador, and Haiti. These projects cover such areas as humanitarian aid, medical assistance, human rights, and sustainable development.
There are a number of opportunities for Taiwanese youth to become involved with humanitarian aid around the world. And the first step is often becoming aware of the issue itself, attending talks or seminars on the topic, such as those held by the Youth Development Administration, can provide an excellent opportunity for young people to understand the humanitarian issues that face the world around them. Another possibility is to join a charity organization they identify with most. For some young people, this might be Ciji because of their religious faith. The Buddhist Ciji Foundation, with 250,000 volunteer workers, has served in 49 countries and provided medical services and emergency relief. Through this, they can then more easily become involved within the broader aims of the organization, or even with other humanitarian assistance programs being offered by other organizations, such as the World Vision Taiwan, which has helped thousands of impoverished and orphaned children around the globe through both public and private sector support.
Another possibility is to participate in an international volunteer program, possibly over the summer or winter vacations. there are a number of such programs with young people particularly in mind. Examples include the WACA program, the Eden Working Holiday, ILF International Services, and the Vision Youth Action Program. All of the above help to create a network of young volunteers, encouraging them to participate in a variety of voluntary activities. The Taiwanese government has also provided financial aid to encourage Taiwanese youth to become involved in humanitarian work overseas. Such involvement is, for many of them, their first step into a larger world.
Thank you.
演讲题目是 Number 5，计时开始。
Good morning, dear judges, teachers, and participants. Today, we're going to talk about the opportunities and the challenges in these emerging societies. Nowadays, the nations in the world are becoming increasingly interconnected, which is called globalization. With globalization, it is more challenging than ever before to expand our knowledge in order to successfully participate in this global community. To do that, we must first understand what opportunities we have and how do we prepare ourselves for the challenges in these rapidly changing societies.
Where your competitors aren't just around you, but all across the globe. These are the issues we have to face both now and in the future. And now, my teammate John is going to talk about the opportunities and the challenges we might face.
Thank you, Alan. Now it's my turn to talk about the opportunities we have and the challenges we might face in the future. Globalization makes specialization possible, allowing different parts of products, for example, to be manufactured in different regions of the world. These create synergies of collaboration, enabling specialists to focus on their business strengths. Taiwan specializes in producing semiconductors. These advantages give us opportunities for international cooperation while globalization is in progress. As for the main challenge we might face, one of the most urgent is the outflow of talent. Winning competition, talent, and expertise are two important keys to surpassing opponents and taking the lead. So, Taiwan's challenge is to find positive way to reduce brain drain. Another challenge in the future we might face is to bridge a gap of wealth inequality around the world. So, we must stop destructive competition and ensure the fairness and justice around the world. And now, my teammate James is going to tell us how to stay competitive in this game of survival.
Thank you, Joan. When globalization strikes, what could we do to turn the challenges into opportunities and survive? Well, being energetic and enthusiastic, we youths need to be more active. We should actively seek ways to connect with the world. But how do we start? First, we can set up websites and platforms to introduce Taiwan and its culture to foreigners. We can also write down what we see and feel about the world in our daily lives, post the latest news, and build strong connections among people. We can agree that sharing thoughts and opinions is a key to promote mutual understanding. We can not only be more responsive, but also build positive relationships between Taiwan and the rest of the world. Lastly, we should be ambitious. Some of us may have the ability to do great things, but we are afraid and don't want to step out of our comfort zone. We shouldn't be afraid of taking the first step into the unknown. If we try, we might fail, but we will fail for sure if we don't even try. And now my teammate Angus would like to share his experience of being competitive and give the conclusion.
Thank you, James. Now I'm going to share my experiences. Well, I was a little passive in the past, but years ago, I talked to my friend who went to Singapore for a youth exchange program. I was a little curious about his trip, so I asked how it was. He said, "Fine." I guess what shocked me the most is that people there are so eager to learn. When they saw the teacher, they are like the pack of hungry wolves. They just rush forward and start throwing questions. After he shared his impressions on the Singaporeans, I began to think, people there are so diligent. What about me? I just read novels and chat with friends all day. I'm not saying that those are bad hobbies, but I realized that I need to be more aggressive instead of being complacent. So I began to take online courses such as Gehan Academy and Coursera, participate in school projects, and now I'm here. Looking back, I'm glad that I overcame the difficulties and obstacles. So my friends, I'm here to encourage you all not to be afraid to take the first step. There are challenges for Taiwan, but we can turn them into opportunities. This way, our country will remain competitive and we will stand strong against other countries. Thank you.
Number 3, 计时开始.
Ladies and gentlemen, today we would like to talk about our observations and experience concerning Southeast Asia. 2 months ago, walking on the street in Taichung, I found myself surrounded by the rhythmic gamelan music and the pungent smell of curry spices. Following the beat and the scent, I found a group of amiable foreigners cooking and dancing in the plaza, with a banner saying, Southeast Asia Culture Festival. Such a scene is not uncommon in Taiwan, since we share a close relationship with Southeast Asian countries. In fact, more than 670,000 Southeast Asians now reside in Taiwan, and Taiwan's export to Southeast Asia ranks second globally. To further strengthen economic relations with this region, our government implemented the new Southward Policy. Numerous projects were launched to enhance mutual exchanges between Taiwan and Southeast Asia, such as the Youth Cultural Gardeners held by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Cultural Exchange Project, sponsored by Taichung ASEAN Square. Up next, my teammate Jason would like to elaborate on his experience this summer.
Thank you, Andre. This summer, I went to visit my grandparents and spent a great amount of time with the Indonesian caretaker, Adi. One day, I found that Adi hadn't eaten anything the whole day. Out of curiosity, I asked her about it, and she explained that she was fasting because of Ramadan. I shadowed her the entire day to experience what it was like, and I learned the purpose of fasting. As described in Quran, it's to attain taqwa, or God consciousness. Like Adi, women wearing hijabs can be easily spotted on streets in Taiwan with the influx of Southeast Asian. They have become part of our everyday life. Thus, we should spare no effort to understand their cultures and open up the gate to mutual understanding and cooperation. Next, Kevin would like to share his observation on Southeast Asia.
Thank you, Jason. Aside from cultural aspect, Taiwan also enjoys a close connection with Southeast Asia economically. Have you ever noticed the labels on your shoes or clothes? 10 years ago, it might say made in China, but now it reads made in Vietnam. Southeast Asian countries have replaced China and become the global manufacturing center. Take Taiwan's Baochun Corporation, the world's largest footwear manufacturer, for example. Among all of their products, a surprisingly 64% are manufactured in Indonesia and Vietnam alone. On the other hand, in terms of politics, Southeast Asian countries are on their path of transition towards democracy. This is where Taiwan can step in. We can offer them with our successful experience of democratization and help them go through this transformative phase peacefully and effectively. Next, my teammate Ray would like to give a conclusion to this topic.
Thank you, Kevin. As stated by my partners, it is obvious that Taiwan and Southeast Asia share a strong bond. In 2017, the Ministry of Education will offer a 1 billion grant to encourage exchange of academics on both sides. Apart from government efforts, Taiwanese youth can also make contribution to facilitating mutual exchanges. For instance, students in Hualien Girls High School held the Immigration Residential Cultural Festival to stimulate interaction between locals and Southeast Asians. Jim O'Neill, who coined the term BRICS in 2001, predicts that Vietnam, Indonesia, and the Philippines will be the new VIP in the world. Consequently, it is through cooperation with a rising force in Southeast Asia that Taiwan can boost local economy and enhance our pivotal role in the global community. Thank you.
Number 3, 计时开始.
As far as economy, politics, and cultural exchanges are concerned, Taiwan undoubtedly has a close relationship with countries of Southeast Asia. Today, we would like to share with you our observation and opinions on the role of our country in Southeast Asia and how people from these countries cooperate, coexist at the same time, and best of all, thrive.
When it comes to the better developed countries in Southeast Asia, Singapore will be the most remarkable country. And it makes sense to say that it is the most powerful country in the world. Although its population of Singapore is comparatively small, it has embraced no fewer achievements than any other countries in Southeast Asia. Singapore has ranked as the Asian four tigers in the world, and its economy has become at the strait of the Malacca, and in
countries like Philippines, Indonesia, and Thailand, those countries, the tourism takes up a huge percentage of their annual income. Today, I'm going to tell you about my personal experience to Philippines. There is a very impressive spot called Puerto Princesa Subterranean River National Park. It is marked as the World Heritage by the UNESCO, and it is one of the seven wonders, one of the new seven wonders of nature. You can only take a man-powered boat into the cave. And after you get into the cave, you can see many bats nestling above you. The pigeon smell is so strong that the pigeon smell is because of their waste. It is so strong that even you are miles away from the cave, you can smell it. And despite the smell, it is the view inside is very spectacular. After you get into the cave, some parts of it is almost as high as three floors. And it is so dark inside that you can't see anything without a flashlight. So I really recommend you to pay a visit. And I'm going to tell you a secret, that
the river is not explored by mankind yet. So go and check this out. Thank you.
Some countries in Southeast Asia are still developing and need finances help. But their improved agriculture techniques and affluent human resources are their advantages. My grandfather has trouble walking, so my family decided to hire a person to take care of him. And thus, I have chance to interact with person from Southeast Asia. At first, I was too shy to interact with her, but after days together, I began to have a chat with her. And to my surprise, she speaks great Chinese. Not only does she take good care of my grandfather, but also passionate and outgoing. Since both of us are interested in each other's cultures and customs, I've told her a lot of about Taiwan's unique culture, like puppet show, bubble milk tea, and temple cultures. From these experiences, I've learned how to interact with people from Southeast Asia and how to respect their unique culture.
So next time, if you had a chance to interact with people from Southeast Asia, you wouldn't want to miss it, because not only can you learn a lot from them, but also you can promote our culture to them. Thank you.
Number 1, 计时开始.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. At the mercy of the ever-accelerated advancements of international technology, great chances have occurred in almost every sphere of our lives. Since information travels fast from place to place, we can benefit a lot from it. In the past, one of the major gaps is the lack of speed. Transportation speed, whether in reality or the virtual world, set up the major issue. It's like buying stuffs on eBay. What we have to do was check the prices of the goods itself and the shipping fee. However, the situation is absolutely different. People adapt themselves in this completely new era where things process more efficiently. And we are very lucky to be in this information age. But we surely need to learn how to apply to this golden opportunity. Next, my friend Mandy is going to share what our government has been doing and how online platforms be used to conduct youth diplomacy.
Thank you, Elvin. The key to youth diplomacy is to be kind, considerate, and thoughtful. So far, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs has established certain amounts of policies for our nation to follow. According to the MOFAT website, we currently share our hospitality to our allied nations by sending both agricultural and aquacultural demonstration teams. Also, we provide concrete, constructive assistance like building houses and improving sanity. However, by using the rapid trade that internet possesses, we could have done a bit more than that. For example, Taiwan can offer online platform for young farmers to promote agricultural produce. Also, we can even form a regional economic cooperation groups. With the help of video conferencing, which makes the communications among countries much more easier than before. As a result, farmers for younger generations could share and learn from each other. Next, my partner Marcus will share with you more.
Thank you, Mandy. Diplomatic actions includes not only assistance and giveaway. It is also a process to let the citizens of two nations feel connected to each other. After all, it is hard to be considerate to people you completely don't know. For example, Panama is one of our ally nations, but few of us know that patagon is a kind of food they eat for daily lives.
clear, we need the power of internet. Our government has been spending decent amount of effort on recruiting youth to introduce these countries by publishing lots of books and documents. Is anyone interested in it? I'm afraid not a lot. Programs like overseas volunteers or working holidays are not easily accessible for those ordinary youngsters. And therefore, it's important for us that we need to know more about our allies and use the online resources like Facebook fan pages or YouTube channels. They can directly promote these projects to the target participants. Next, Yang is going to give you a summary of our speech.
So before I give my summary, I would like to share with you more instances. In the past, we used to send the youth doctors and youth teachers to Africa in order to help with their educations or medical. But now, thanks to the internet, we can use like distant teaching or distant medical, which will even recruit more volunteers for us because we no longer have to go to Africa in order to devote ourselves. So now, to sum up, we have understood that internet possesses a rapid trade, and it really does benefit a lot for us. It can reduce the gap and distance between nations and nations, so we need to find a good way to use it. Here are some suggestions to follow. First, we can use the internet to share our experience or share our ideas. We can even use it to promote our product to the world. In the past, only government officials can do that in the international meetings, but now, thanks to the internet, unofficial youth exchanging is possible. Second, we can use the internet to get to know other nations more, such as our ally nations or destination nations. We only used to get these information from books or encyclopedia, but now we get to watch the video or even creating our own video on introducing our nations. So after that, even the interactive Wikipedia has replaced the boring encyclopedia, which often makes people feel boring. So for summarize, internet really is a powerful, precise, and efficient tool. We really need to get a hang of it to reach the maximum output that we wish to receive. Thank you.
Number 1, 计时开始.
When it comes to the topic of how we may use the advanced information technology on the internet to conduct youth diplomacy, what popped into mind is through some international social network application like Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, just to name a few. With the advances in cyber technology nowadays, how we can take good use of information technology becomes more and more important. Through the vast information social network, we can get to access to or be exposed to much more global information than ever before. Next, my teammate Max will elaborate on just that.
Thank you, Edward. In this fast-changing society today, there's no doubt that how to use internet to communicate is an important issue. Most people, especially youth, nowadays use Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, or social network app like such to interact with one another. It's the trend. The US President Obama once used the internet to deliver a speech through the internet on the relationship with Iran. Young people, therefore, can be exposed to the international issues concerning by diplomatic relationship, also expanding their global horizon on the internet platform. Yet, the Obama example isn't the only one. There has been a great deal of information regarding to the issues of international diplomatic relationship uploaded to the social network as previously cited. It's the simple truth that youth today spend more time engaging in social network websites rather than watching TV channels. Next, my teammate Kevin will focus on the positive power of internet with an example.
Thank you, Max. With cyber technology know-how,
people can connect and be connected with youth around the world. It's exactly the scene that describes Jasmine Revolution in Tunisia. In January 2011, Tunisian youth protested against the government. The demonstrators used social network to express their emotions and disappointment through social network to It's obvious that the answer lies in cyber technology. It's the display of the power of the internet. Next, my teammate Mingqi will focus on the negative power of internet.
Thank you, Kevin. So it has demonstrated how influential the social network can possibly be. Then I'm going to cite on ISIS, Islam State in Iraq and Syria as an example to show the downside of internet. The ISIS has taken the advantage of the internet, like Twitter, to disperse the revolution idea to call for the Muslim youth from all around the world to support them action in war. Many Muslim youth believe in Muslim doctrine. Many Muslim youth believe in the Muslim doctrine from all around the world, only to find their liberty has been taken and be treated as a sex slave, a female, suicidal warriors and the terrorists. Next, my teammate Edward will conclude the speech for us.
Thank you, Mingqi. With the upside and downside effect demonstrated, website serving as information platform can literally have great influence on global youth today. For Taiwanese youth to conduct youth diplomacy through the internet is quite easy. We can simply make foreigners as kipo, which is the same concept like having pen pal through written letters. While upon communicating with kipos on social media like Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, don't forget that we're representing Taiwan as a youth ambassador. Our foreigner friends get to know more everything about Taiwan through the interaction we have with them. Thank you.
Honorable
judges, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Living in a global village, we know that it is impossible for us to limit ourselves to our own country and isolate ourselves from others. With rapid development of science and technology, it goes without saying that keeping in close touch with our neighbors and establishing a good interactive is very important. We, Chinese youth, having abundant resources provided by our country, are able to take part in international activities and thus have more and more opportunities to expand our international perspective. For instance, with the help of the internet, we can obtain information and know what's happening in the world from online media and social networking sites, almost without time difference. Apart from the virtual space, there are more resources to link us with all over the world, both inside and outside of our country. Next, Tina will talk more about on this topic.
It is fundamental for us Taiwanese youth to voice our views and opinions on international stages and strengthen the link with the international community. Take the International Youth Ambassadors Exchange Program, run by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, for example. Every year, 160 outstanding representatives are selected from over 1,000 college students. They then undergo 6 weeks of training before being split into 8 groups that travel all over the world to introduce Taiwan with passion and verve. Their footsteps have left on the refugee camp in Syria, the orphanage in Mongolia to provide humanitarian aid. They have also visited Paraguay and El Salvador to strengthen the bonds of diplomatic allies. We can also apply for a working holiday program so that we may stay and work in a foreign country, experience a new lifestyle, and make friends with people across the world. Do you agree, Claire?
Yes, Tina. I can't agree with you more. Besides these programs provided by the government, the school where we are studying holds a cultural exchange camp every year to promote a global learning community by establishing international bonds from students around the world. In the camp, we students work as hosts to serve delegates from other countries, including Japan, Korea, the USA, Scotland, Australia, and Austria. By doing so, we can learn from the youth across the world, gain a better understanding and tolerance for other countries. Next, Sammy will give you her idea and make a conclusion on this topic.
As illustrated by my partners, we know that there are truly plenty of resources that we may take advantage of, thanks to the efforts provided by the government and the private sector. We youngsters can now make use of those channels to enhance international engagements and exchanges. We can know what's happening around us through the internet. We can express and exchange our thoughts and ideas by joining forums for discussions of international affairs. Also, we can get involved in worldwide movements or voluntary work to see the real world with our own eyes. However, all the resources are just like windows. We may see every corner of the globe through the windows, but if we choose not to open them, we would definitely see nothing. Therefore, it is the attitudes we hold toward this global community that count. We should not be indifferent, but be attentive to our world, because only when we care from the heart and actively participate in international activities can we truly expand our international vision. Thank you for listening.
演讲题目是 Number 5, 计时开始。
Dear judges, our topic is number 5. Globalization is a process of international integration arising from the development of transportation, information technology, and mass media. It includes culture, economy, media, and so on. It transforms the world into a global village. But how could it affect the world? At the end of 2010, the Tunisian Revolution preceded Arab Spring, and some countries followed with a series of campaigns which pushed the democracy and economic improvement. These campaigns came from public demonstration and attracted media attention as well as public opinion. From this example, we can know that autocracy can be changed by the democracy and the new technique of globalization.
Apart from that, globalization also threatens the world. Take the current Syrian civil war, for example. Through the recent intervention of America, China, Russia, and the great power of Persian areas, the war turned out to be a proxy war. Because of globalization, the intense society conflicts expand to an international stage, which will lead to a more unstable world. Stopping the world is a priority over our own benefits, which the current world has to face. Next, let's think of Taiwan. Affected by globalization, people pay closer attention to international affairs and we realize the importance of being global citizens. And we Taiwan also seize the opportunity with our soft power.
Taiwan's cultural and creative products have a human favor because of it mixed with the moderate sense of hand, local culture, and habits. When the history changes in the passage of time, the creativities will evolve. Moreover, globalization can be the poison. For example, rockfish in Taiwan is an industry, and it is expensive in China. It became a curse these years because China tried to attract fishermen in Taiwan, go there and work, and have a high salary. However, so how to balance the current economic and long-term development is one of the influences of Taiwan's economy.
Globalization can help developing countries to catch up on the developed country. So making we Taiwanese be more competitive is our priority. To achieve this, we youth can make good use of our creativity, since it's our wealth. We can see that from previous example of creative industries in Taiwan. Creative industries can make us to be more competitive because it's ability that other people can steal or learn. So we think improve our competitive is our first goal to achieve.
Bow.
Thank you.
Number 4, 计时开始.
Examples of humanitarian efforts could be sparsely found through our recorded history. However, it was not until the latter part of the 19th century that humanitarian efforts became more widespread. Many historians agree that the forming of the International Red Cross in 1863 marked the beginning of the organized humanitarian efforts. Most developed countries recognize that humanitarian efforts are an important part of a foreign country's policy. So, should we as students become more involved? Yes, we should. By becoming involved in humanitarian efforts, we become a better citizen in our own country. But more importantly, we become a better neighbor in the global community. So, what should we do? Mark.
The first things we can do is to raise awareness of a problem. We can become the voice for those people who cannot speak for themselves. If, for example, a tsunami devastates one of our neighboring countries, it will be very difficult for them to call for help. No phones, no internet. But if we are aware of the problem, then we can help make other people in our school and communities aware. Once people are aware of the problem, then they will begin working on how to solve it. Also, we can do such things like collecting food for those in need, or collecting money and send it to the people who need it.
Kenny. To raise awareness, we must pay more attention to the news and less attention to computer games we love to play. If we follow the projected path of typhoons, for example, we are better able to prepare for when the typhoon does hit and cause its damage. If we, as students, are more willing to come to the aid of our neighbors in their time of need, they will be more willing to help us when we need their help. However, we cannot help our neighbors if we are unaware of any problems. Therefore, we must pay more attention to the world around us and less attention to Pokemon Go, for example. Once we are aware of a problem, we must spread the word to anyone that can help. It only takes one person to get started. We must be the leaders. We must take initiatives. Sandy.
Collecting food is another way we can help. Food items in cans and bottled water are very cheap, and we have easy access to these items. And canned food and bottled water can go a long way to helping others recover from a disaster. Think about yourself and your family. When a typhoon is coming to Taiwan, what is the first thing your mother goes to a store to buy? Canned food and bottled water. Why? Because if we lose the electricity, the food in our refrigerators goes bad, we can still eat. So, if people in Japan are hit by a volcano, for example, what will they need? Food and water, right? How much effort would it really require from us to collect food and water at school and send the food and water to a neighboring country? Mark.
It really would not be that difficult. All we need to do is to set up a table at the entrance of the school and let people drop off their donations on the table. But how do we send it? Our teachers and parents can help with this. They can help us contact with the organization, such as the International Red Cross. And these organizations will ensure that our foods and water we collected will be sent to the right place to help the right people. As a student, we are the future.
Wow. Thank you very much.
Number 4, 计时开始.
When I was just a little girl, maybe 5 years old, I kept a coin bank shaped like a loaf of bread. By adding coins to the bread, I was helping children on the other side of the world by donating money to the World Vision. It was then that I realized that no matter how old we are, it's always the right age to contribute toward humanitarian aid. Honorable judges, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. The more we give, the more we receive. Over 60 years ago, Taiwan was the beneficiary of humanitarian aid. But today, we are in a position to give back. Though we are teenagers, we can still reach out our helping hands to those in need. First of all, let's hear from Max.
Thank you, Ashley. It's true that Taiwan has been engaged in humanitarian effort for quite some time. One obvious example is our contribution to Japan. Following the catastrophic events of March 11, 2011, Taiwan immediately sent relief aid and recruited medical teams to provide critical assistance. I'm sure many of you remember a devastating earthquake followed by a tsunami resulted in the meltdown of Fukushima's nuclear power plant. In total, there were over 20,000 casualties and billions of dollars in structural damage. Upon hearing of the disaster, many young people in Taiwan not only donated money, but also lent emotional support by writing letters, sending gifts, or even making heartfelt videos. No matter where in the world people need help, we're eager to do what we can. And consequently, these selfless efforts win respect for Taiwan from the international community. But there's more. Fuki?
Thank you, Max. Taiwanese youth inventions also contribute to humanitarian aid. Since 2009, our government has funded the project Lighting Up Africa to illuminate thousands of households and schools in African countries with LED lamps. In countries like Burkina Faso, children now have artificial lights after sunset, and it allows them to study at night, which is something they were not able to do before. Up to now, this program has provided more than 126,000 light bulbs. Moreover, the kids are encouraged to use solar panels to recharge the batteries at school, which boosted their school enrollment rates and students' academic performance. None of this would be possible without the research and development abilities of young people from Taiwan. Over the last decade, Taiwanese students have won numerous prizes in international invention contests, showing our commitment to ongoing humanitarian aid projects. What do you think, Daniel?
Thank you, Fuki. Taiwanese youth do bring light to our global village. But there's more we can do to better the world. Last year, my classmates and I participated in the World Vision's 30-hour famine campaign. Through 30 hours of fasting, we truly experienced starvation, the same starvation suffered by more than 10% of the world's population. The exact same starvation that takes away a child's life every 10 seconds. Deeply inspired by this activity, we also adopted a girl in Zambia named Tandi. Last Christmas, we spent 3,000 NT buying Tandi and her family a goat. Now, her family is able to sell the goat's milk and use that money to buy more seeds and fertilizer, and thus sustaining their farm and ultimately their livelihood. 3,000 NT might not be a lot of money to us, but it is more than enough to ignite a spark of hope in a child. By actively participating in global humanitarian aid projects, we surely fulfill our duty as a member in this global community. Back to you, Ashley.
Thank you, Daniel. Indeed, Taiwanese youth's efforts to help those in need are universally recognized. We offered immediate aid right after the Fukushima disaster. The project, Lighting Up Africa, improves people's lives and education through technology. And the World Vision's 30-hour famine allowed us to walk a mile in the shoes of a starving child. Ladies and gentlemen, let's embrace the world with love from Taiwan. Thank you.
Number 5, 计时开始.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Globalization is a process of global economic, political, and cultural integration. It has changed the world into a smaller village because the borders have been erased between countries. It can be said that globalization has certain advantages, such as economic processes, technological developments, political influences, and health systems. Undoubtedly, globalization has created new opportunities for every country in the world. However, it is not true that all effects of this phenomenon are positive. Why? Because globalization has also brought up new challenges, such as environmental degradation, instability in financial and commercial markets, and an increasing inequity within and across nations. Now, my partners will elaborate more about the opportunities and challenges that globalization has brought to the world, including Taiwan, and amid this wave of globalization, how Taiwanese youth can stay competitive.
Thank you, Jason. Globalization has indeed brought both opportunities and challenges to the world. For instance, it helps developing countries to increase their economic growth, which also contributes to their health and education systems. Especially for Taiwan, the education has increased in recent years. because globalization is a catalyst to the jobs requiring higher skill sets. Furthermore, globalization also has a great impact on culture. It's convenient for people to introduce diverse or creative ideas to each other. However, many countries are concerned that the rise of globalization might lead to destruction of their own culture, tradition, and even their language. For instance, Taiwanese students start to learn foreign languages from a very young age. But fewer children now are able to speak or even understand the dialects their grandparents use. From this, we can see globalization is irresistible. So, my partner William will talk about what Taiwanese youth should do to confront this wave of globalization.
Thank you, Megan. Globalization has already accelerated the economic growth in many developing countries and make them stronger competitors against Taiwan. Under these circumstances, Taiwanese need to think about how to stay competitive. Now, we are facing the new world with fewer markets, easier communication, more opportunities to obtain education. All these seem to make life more ideal. However, it also demonstrates we are going to have tougher battles to fight for the adequate life. If we want to stay competitive, we not only need to have professional knowledge and a good communication ability, but we also must start paying attention to the international events and trends to extend our international perspectives. Moreover, we should know the diplomatic policies of our own government well and proactively participate in international events and competitions. Lastly, we should travel and study abroad more. All these will enable Taiwanese youth to conquer their opponents in this more competitive world.
Exactly, William.
As we can see, every country has been affected greatly by globalization, both positively and negatively. On one hand, the economies of these countries have improved under the influence of globalization, and this helps enhance the quality of education and health systems, bringing a better life to all of mankind. On the other hand, globalization has also brought many drawbacks to us as well. For instance, many cultures and customs are disappearing because of it. However, whether we like it or not, our generation has already been drawn into this globalizing torrent. It is unstoppable. All we can do is prepare ourselves to go with the current of the times. Therefore, we need to be professional in our job field and know how to communicate with others. More importantly, we need to have an international perspective and be active in international events and competitions. By doing so, we, Taiwanese youth, will definitely be able to enhance our own competitiveness and let ourselves shine on the global stage.
Number 3, 计时开始.
Ladies and gentlemen, today we are going to talk about the relationships between Taiwan and Southeast Asia. We know that there is a horrible tragedy taking place in Paris last year. Once the news was released, the world's attention is drawn to this tragedy. People from the world showed their compassion by praying for the victims. Some countries raised the flag of France, and we also projected the image on the wall of Taipei 101. Once the news was released, some people changed their profile picture on Facebook to show support. But what we didn't know is that there was a tragedy taking place in Myanmar at the same time. A group of refugees called Rohingya were forced to leave their countries for political issues. About 25,000 people fled to countries like Thailand, Malaysia. More than 300 people died on their journey. The news was rarely reported in Taiwan, So many of us were unaware of such a horrible incident. Ironically, the distance between Taiwan and France is almost four times larger than that between Taiwan and Myanmar. Even though we're so close to Southeast Asia in geographical terms, it seems that we know so little about this region. And now, my teammate Amber will continue the speech.
Actually, we have very close relationships with Southeast Asia. According to the Ministry of Interior, there are about 600,000 people from Southeast Asia working in Taiwan, and the number has been growing for years. Besides, many Southeast Asian people immigrated to Taiwan for marriage. For example, among all the Taiwanese getting married last year, 13% of them have a cross-national marriage, which means that 13% of the newlyweds have a spouse from another country. And one-third of the foreign spouses are from Southeast Asia. This means a lot to Taiwan, because how to immerse these immigrants and their children becomes an important issue. Besides, Taiwan and Southeast Asia are becoming more interdependent because of our commercial transactions. According to the data released by the Investment Commission of Ministry of Economic Affairs, the number of Taiwanese entrepreneurs setting up factories in China plunged by 55% last year, and most of them are aiming to move to Vietnam. So we can see that the bond between Taiwan and Southeast Asia are becoming much closer now, whether it is about labor, marriage, or business. And now, my teammate Kathy will continue the speech.
In my personal experience, people in Southeast Asia are generally open-minded and welcomes everyone no matter where they are from. Take my trip to Malaysia as an example. When I visited there, a guide fervently introduced water entertainment to us. After having some conversations, we realized that he had no vicious intentions, and it was ourselves that failed to open our mind. Throughout the day, he introduced you many interesting stories about his country and culture, which made our trip more fun. At the end of the day, he even asked if we would like to try some local cuisines with his family. In one word, this guide, as well as many local we met there, were all passionate, and they made me feel like at home. And now, my teammate, Iris, will continue the speech.
In contrast to their passionate attitude, many people in Taiwan do not treat them in the same way. It is not rare to see those immigrants from Southeast Asia labeled as the inferior citizens. Besides, they are usually classified into the special ethnic group and should be treated differently. But we all should keep this in mind. All humans are created equal. Those immigrants from Southeast Asians, they lead their life just like everyone does. They raise children, work hard to support family, and strive for a better life opportunities. If we don't like those Westerners who consider themselves are better than us, how can we do the same thing to those Southeast Asians? Taiwan is becoming a multi-ethnic society. We should adapt ourselves to this change. Get rid of the stereotype and fix the undermined relationship between Taiwanese and those immigrants. After all, Taiwan is our mutual home. Thank you.
Number 4, 计时开始。
Humanitarian assistance is defined as upholding human dignity, providing material or logistic support to save lives, and bring relief to those who need it. In Taiwan, humanitarian assistance has become a trend. For example, in Taiwan, sorry. For example, for a simple concept of spreading love, a young man chooses an alternative formed for military service or spreading love. A young man chooses an alternative for military service after college by volunteering in Burkina Faso.
He was Dr. Lian Jiaen. In Burkina Faso, people were starving, disease was raging, there was no garbage removal and lack of clean drinking water. However, Dr. Lian Jiaen stood out as he and his medical team provide service and ask for nothing in return. To help clean up the environment, he came up with an idea of old clothes in exchange of garbage, thus resolving the garbage problem as people start cleaning up to get clothes, another scarce commodity. However, education in Burkina Faso is just a faraway dream. So Dr. Lian Jiaen came up with the idea to raise funds and build orphanages to support the locals' education. When people asked him, why was he doing this? He replied, why not? Through his answer, he shows that not only he possessed a good moral character, but also the true spirit of humanitarian who want to improve people's life. For world citizen today, his endeavor is worthy of learning.
We may not have the ability to build orphanages or provide medical assistance, but by learning Dr. Lian's story, at least we can try to make some efforts. Humanitarian assistance shouldn't be limited to diplomacy through governments. We, youth, can also try our best to contribute to international assistance. Small-scale programs like donating aid materials can help those in need. Carrying a kilogram more is a simple, charitable traveling activity. It encourages travelers to bring something for others, like bringing stationery, books, or medical equipment for disadvantaged schools, children, or medical units.
Humanitarian assistance increases our experience and teaching us the skills that can help people in need to survive or help more people in the future. Lending a helping hand to others benefits them. Instead, we can also gain a sense of achievement, fulfillment, and enriching our minds. Humanitarian assistance is neither just about giving, nor about the wealthy countries show of their power. It is just lending a helping hand to whoever needs it. Owing to the limitation of funds and language and the age, it may be a little bit difficult for students to reach out to the world every day. However, we can start from changing our minds, being more content with those basic things we already have, and empathizing with those in need, and that's a good start.
To those who are in need, we can help them within our ability.
In short, when it comes to caring for others, we shouldn't be limited within the national borderline or the sea around the island of Taiwan.
We are the world, and we should be as one. And that is what we call a youth with global vision.
Thank you.
演讲题目是 Number 5，计时开始。
Good morning, judges. A cheeseburger from McDonald's, a macchiato from Starbucks, and a selfie with an iPhone. Are these part of your daily life? In fact, these products and services all indicate one prevalent phenomenon, globalization. Because of globalization, traveling time is decreased, international communication is increased, and free trade are spurred. And with this whirlwind, opportunities emerge. Developed countries can enjoy the free flow of capital to invest, while corporations now have greater flexibility to operate across borders. Developing countries, on the other hand, can trade their rich natural resources and human labor as products and services of all type. Transportation of goods and people now are made so much easier, and democratic ideas are gradually nourishing the minds of many. Now, let's take our focus back to our home, Taiwan. Local and small companies now get a chance to improve their quality and standards, while consumers are available to new choices and more alternatives for products, all thanks to globalization. Next, my teammate Wendy will tell you how globalization influences the world.
Thank you, Johnny. However, globalization has also brought along unprecedented challenges. The once valued job loyalty no longer exists. Skilled and non-skilled jobs flow from developed countries to developing countries because the interest-seeking company outsources most of their work to save money. Sometimes, workers are exploited, and in turn, cheap and undesirable quality goods are manufactured. Worse yet, corporations take advantage of weaker regulatory rules, resulting in serious pollution detrimental to the environment and human health. Here in Taiwan, people and businesses can't avoid the challenges of globalization either. For instance, a lot of farmers and employees are thrown out of work after the accession of WTO's membership. Taiwan's export sector has been threatened by an outbreak of the inevitable price wars in key markets. There are also losses of indigenous cultures and unique living styles, let alone the environmental pollution due to the various forms of waste discharge. Next, my teammate Athena will tell you how we can stay competitive under globalization.
Thank you, Wendy. In a time that is both extremely exciting and trying, how can we prepare ourselves to face the many tomorrows to come? As a Taiwanese youth, I believe the acquisition of language proficiency, the participation in world events, and appreciation of Taiwan's soft power and innovation are answers to how we can stay competitive in the wake of globalization. First, we all have to be fluent in English. In order to supply the research facilities around the globe with armies of scientists and engineers. Second, we should strive for chances to study abroad, take part in working holiday programs, and participate in world events and organizations. Be it a member of International Cultural Youth Exchange, a volunteer worker in World Vision, or a delegate in international NGOs. We all can gain meaningful cultural exposures and exert our influences. Third, to stay competitive under globalization, we Taiwanese youth should cultivate the 5 C's abilities. That is communication, collaboration, complex problem solving, critical thinking, and creativity. By using and combining the 5 C's, which is imperative at the forefront of the 21st century, we can prepare ourselves to tackle the unexpected developments in the global market. Lastly, my teammate Jonathan will tell you about Taiwan's soft power.
Thank you, Athena. Finally, we should never lose sight of Taiwan's soft power, which include human rights, democracy, peace, love, and high technology. We should keep developing more globally famous brands that boost Taiwan's presence not only in high-tech sections, but also in art, food, and fashion. We Taiwanese youth should also reach out more by providing generous humanitarian assistance to countries struck by war and disasters.
we can also broadcast Taiwan's beauty and grace through popular social media, such as Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube in a ubiquitous cyberspace. All in all, only by empowering ourselves through language proficiency, active involvement, and 5C abilities can we remote Taiwan as a competitive, innovative, and confident partner emulated in global community. This is the end of our speech. Thank you.
Number 5, 计时开始。
In this day and age, the quick development of technology has influenced the whole world by bringing people together through the internet. We can interact with anyone, anywhere, with a click of a mouse. What is happening on the other side of the world does not seem so far away. Thanks to globalization and economics, one shirt sold in the United States could have been made from Chinese cotton by workers in Thailand. Then it could have been shipped on a French freighter that had a Spanish crew. The boundaries between countries become blurred. Each one of us now becomes intertwined. Since globalization is something unavoidable, what are the opportunities and challenges of globalization for the world and Taiwan? Besides, how can we stay competitive amid this wave of globalization? Next, I'll invite Andrew to explain for us.
What is globalization? It is the worldwide movement toward economic, financial, trade, and communication integration. Since it is a big issue, here we try to focus on the job market. In January 2009, Tourism Queensland launched a global search to find a caretaker of the islands of the Great Barrier Reef. Could you imagine a Taiwanese working on the other side of the world? It's only possible in the 21st century. However, on the other hand, the challenges are fierce competitions for a job opening. Your rivals may not be just locals, but also the international competitors. It turns out that Ben Southall from England beat nearly 35,000 applicants for the dream position. Next, I'll invite Florence to continue the topic.
So, how can we stay competitive? How can we, the Taiwanese youth, find jobs? To stay competitive in the wave of globalization, we need to acquire both hard skills and soft skills. Hard skills are specific abilities that we learn at school, such as reading, writing, math, and the ability to use software programs. We should study hard and try to master the job-related skills. However, as the world becomes increasingly globalized, language skills are probably the most important ones for getting ahead in the global job market. So, understand the industry you're trying to get into. Learn one or two other languages. Bring something more to your job. For example, being a computer programmer in a financial institution is great. But being a computer programmer that understands finance is better. And the best is being a computer programmer that understands finance and also speaks fluent English. Next, I'll invite Rebecca to introduce the soft skills part.
By contrast, soft skills are harder to qualify, such as etiquette, getting along with others, listening, and engaging in small talk. And of all the qualities, we would like to stress the importance of etiquette and cultural sensitivity. Always be polite so that you will give people a good first impression. As for cultural sensitivity, be aware of cultural differences. For example, in Bulgaria, nodding one's head means no. A positive gesture in a country can mean something quite different in another. So, hone your cultural awareness.
To sum up, globalization not only gives us a lot of opportunities, but also a great number of challenges. While we are just students, we have to seize the chance to broaden our knowledge and acquire new skills. To stay competitive, we need to work on both hard skills and soft skills. With both kinds of skills at hand, we can definitely be well equipped to deal with all the possible challenges when we face globalization in the near future. Thank you.
Number 5. 计时开始.
I am the citizen of the world. You know what? I didn't say this. A Greek philosopher said this 1,000 years ago. Globalization is an inevitable process since countries have opened up themselves to communicate with the world. We may be the one who benefits or the one who disadvantages in the globalizing world. First and foremost, we'll be elaborating on what opportunities and advantages that globalization have brought to the world and Taiwan in our own aspect.
Estella.
Thank you, Ingrid. Due to globalization, youngsters around the world now get lots of opportunities to interact with the outside world. We can enjoy diversified options and enrich ourselves with multiple cultures. For example, when I walk around the streets in Taiwan, I see all kinds of traditional foods from Thailand, Hong Kong, Vietnam, and even across the world from South Africa. This phenomenon not only comes with food, but also in clothing and lifestyle. What's more important is that we can engage ourselves as interns in foreign enterprises to take part in this globalized world. The variety of culture that globalization has offered us is limitless. These are just a few examples of the opportunities and advantages that globalization has brought to us. Next, Jimmy will be digging into the consequences and challenges we have to face afterwards.
Thank you, Estella. Indeed, we can experience colorful customs throughout globalization. But what about the negativities that comes after? Many unique but lesser known culture can be marginalized by people around the globe. The thinking, lifestyle, and languages of lesser known can be harshly taken over by the mainstream culture. And that's exactly what's happening in Taiwan. Taiwan traditional culture now only exists along the countryside. Besides the culture affected by the challenges, it also widened the poverty gap. Capitalism around the world now only exists around the world. For instance, a friend of mine from Tainan told me recently that their family business had to be shut down. Reason being that with more competitive foreign brands influencing, people in Taiwan tend to buy cheaper and more attractive products from them. In short, foreign factories have beaten our native industry through globalization. Therefore, how can we thrive through the challenges and remain competitive? Emily.
Thank you, Jimmy. Though young as we may be, we should contain ourselves with decent personalities and skills. So first, we should learn multiple languages so we can communicate with people around the world. Because it is almost impossible for us to confine ourselves to our comfort zone in this globalized world. Second, we should always possess a challenging mindset because the domestic culture in Taiwan might be facing foreign impact, and we, as youth in Taiwan, we must strive to protect our culture. Third, last but not least, we should always travel and keep moving and stay active, because traveling is one of the best way to expose ourselves to the outside world so we can learn, emerge, and innovate. Take myself as an example. In this summer, I stepped out of my comfort zone and I went to UCLA pre-college program and study there. So Los Angeles is one of the most diversified cities in the entire world. Because I can speak fluent English, I was able to join in discussion and make friends with them and live a true Californian life. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. Globalization has both positive and negative impacts for the world and Taiwan. We, as today's youngsters and future adults, should adjust ourselves to the world by equipping ourselves with challenging mindset, multiple language skills, most importantly, keep updated with the latest events. Remember, Taiwan's future is counting on every single one of us, and we are responsible for it. Thank you for your attention.
Number two, 计时开始.
Good morning. I have a vision of the world as a global village, a world without boundaries. This was a quote by Krista McAuliffe 30 years ago. And today, the world has indeed become an internationally active country, allowing active engagements between countries. However, due to our ambiguous status, Taiwan has constantly been at a disadvantage in these international exchanges. That is why, as the future of Taiwan, the importance of youths participating in these international exchanges is ever so significant. Thus, the question arises, how?
One flaw in Taiwanese youth is that we rely heavily on books and knowledge when it comes to understanding another country. This is mainly because we do not have the necessary resources to travel. Because of such factors, many organizations, including the government, has provided numerous programs in hopes of encouraging youth to step out of Taiwan and broaden their visions. As a youth of Taiwan, participating in these programs are not just ways to take a trip, but rather a chance to experience the difference between lifestyles and customs. You may find that what we consider to be sensible and polite behavior at home may not be perceived in the same fashion outside of our borders. For example, giving certain flowers in Russia or certain gestures in Greece may be seen as impolite and rude. And aside from that, traveling also enables youth to reflect on their own lifestyles, potentially changing them and Taiwan's community for the better.
Because the footstep of globalization grows rapid by day, more and more organizations have been looking for ways to encourage our youth to participate in global activities, whether through wireless or actual communication. For example, organizations such as the Taiwanese Youth Rights Organizations provides opportunity for youth to interact with global experts from the UN regarding the topic of chosen rights. Other groups such as the Taiwan World Youth Volunteer Association encourage our youth to take part in global exchanges and teachings of needing places. Still, there are other parties, organizations, and even schools all providing channels to encourage our youth to engage with the length of the world.
However, to engage with the width of the world, we must first engage with the one closest to us, China. Due to political issues and incompatible ideas, only a small portion out of almost 7 million youth has been to China. Thus, many non-government organizations and online communities alike have been encouraging the exchange between the youth of both regions. These activities include combined forums involving the youth of both Taiwan and China to communicate and exchange perspectives on certain topics. By participating in these exchanges, the youth of China can learn about the cultures and values of Taiwanese youth, in turn gain a better understanding of the other party, and vice versa. Through these exchanges, our youths may finally learn to accept other cultures with a comprehensive heart, and at the same time, spread our own positive qualities with others.
The world is rapidly becoming a globalized village, and with that, the rise in the frequency of exchanges between cultures and ethnic groups.
In an urgent time like this, it is our duty as the youth of Taiwan to make good use of international mediums and broaden our visions, whether through traveling or exchanges.
Taiwan may be an island surrounded by sea, but if you open your eyes, the world is all around us, and us, all around the world.
Thank you.
Number 3, 计时开始.
Good morning, judges, and good luck, fellow competitors. Now we will tell you Taiwan's role in Southeast Asia. Southeast Asia is a sub-region that consists of nearly 750 million people that are culturally diverse, speaks many different languages, and practice varying religions. Despite all of the differences, the countries of Southeast Asia have learned to work hand in hand to make their small area of the world one of the fastest developing regions. Southeast Asia traditionally consists of the 11 countries, and while Taiwan might not fit the criteria of acceptance for being a Southeast Asian country. If you took a closer look beyond the map, you will see Taiwan's as a major contributor to the region. Due to globalization, Taiwan's ties to Southeast Asia have learned to work hand in hand. So now Baxter will tell you about the politics of Southeast Asia.
Thanks, Frank.
Even though that Taiwan is not geographically part of Southeast Asia, if you take a look at the countries politically, you'll be able to see that Taiwan is right at home being included in the region. The first thing that all of the countries have in common is that all of them have broken free from colonization. Decolonization is a hard-fought process filled with struggle and bloodshed. This fight for freedom has molded each country and left their citizens with a great sense of national pride. All of the countries in Southeast Asia have achieved independence, but not all of them taken the same path with their governments. Problems usually arise when countries with monarchies, dictatorships, and democracies try to work together. But through collaboration and negotiations, the countries have set aside most problems to advance their countries. Even though that these countries need one another for success, they do not always see eye to eye on every international issue. Next up is Jamie. He will tell you about the economics of the region.
Thanks, Baxter. Whether you consider Taiwan part of Southeast Asia or not, it is undeniable that Taiwan's economy directly influences the other countries of the region. Due to Taiwan's geographical location, Taiwan has connected itself to the countries of Southeast Asia. Tourism and trade have been the main ways that Taiwan connected itself to the countries of Southeast Asia. And today, these two sectors continue to be extremely important and growing the aspect of the economies and of all the countries. Tourists from Southeast Asia are vital to Taiwan's economy. So much so that just last week, Taiwan extended a free tourist visa program to more countries to increase the number of visitors coming to our island. While tourism is important, higher trade with countries of Southeast Asia is what Taiwan wants to achieve. Nothing will increase the number of visitors coming to our island. Instead, Taiwan joining Association of Southeast Asia Nations. Taiwan is not currently a member of this international group due to its current standing globally. Political blockade by China preventing Taiwan's membership in the international community. Next, Maggie will discuss the cultural aspect of Southeast Asia.
Due to the before mentioned economic and political connection Taiwan has with Southeast Asia,
it was unavoidable that the culture of those regions would have taken root in Taiwan. Food, religion, and custom had made its way to the street of Taipei. How did this happen, you may be asking yourself. The reason lies with the immigrant workers who came to Taiwan from many of the countries of Southeast Asia. Due to the interconnection of the country's economies, foreign workers came to Taiwan to work, bring along their culture to share and spread with the Taiwanese citizens. An example of how these workers has made Taiwan more culturally diverse is the introduction of the Muslim culture. Immigrants from Malaysia and Indonesia has bring their culture and set up mosques in throughout Taiwan. During times of religious festival, you can go to Taipei Main Station to experience firsthand the excitement and the uniqueness of those regions. As you can see, Taiwan and Southeast Asia has many cultural, economic, and politics similarities that brings the countries closer together.
Wow.
Thank you.
Number 3, 计时开始.
Honorable judges, dear teachers and fellow students, I'm Joanne. Today, we're going to share some of our observations on the economies, cultures of Southeast Asia, and describe our experiences in interacting with its people. When walking around Taipei or the whole island of Taiwan, we can see some foreign laborers working at the construction sites or in the factory. Besides, over the past decades, Taiwan has seen an increasing number of foreign women marrying into local families. We know that most of them come from the countries of Southeast Asia. Therefore, we came to be interested in their countries, hoping to better understand their hometown and wondering why they leave their countries and work abroad or even marry a foreign husband in spite of the language barriers and cultural differences. The following are some of the observations regarding the countries of Southeast Asia. Next, my teammate Tiffany will start with their political situations.
Southeast Asia consists of 11 countries that reach from eastern India to China, and is generally divided into mainland and island zones. The mainland is made up of Burma, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam, while maritime Southeast Asia includes Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, the Philippines, Brunei, and the new nation of East Timor. In economy, 10 of them make up the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, which is one of the fastest growing business markets in the world. As for the culture, a distinctive feature of Southeast Asia is its diversity of culture, language, and religion. Indonesia, for example, is almost 90% Muslim, while the Philippines is more than 80% Roman Catholic, and Thailand is more than 95% Buddhist. Besides, every country has its own unique culture. With such diverse culture and religion, it must be amazing to visit these countries. One of our teammates, Christina, happened to be an exchange student in Singapore. Therefore, next she will share her experiences in interacting with its people.
In the summer of 2013, I participate in an exchange student to go to Singapore, one of the countries in Southeast Asia. The program lasts 3 weeks. During my stay, the first thing I noticed is that the diversity of the races in the country, such as Malay, Chinese, Indians, and Europeans. But despite the differences, they were able to coexist peacefully and even form a unique culture. Those who have been to Singapore would know, although English is their national language, their conversation is usually mixed with the random phrases of Chinese and Taiwanese. They even have their own unique accents. Thus, their language becomes globally known as Singlish. What impressed me the most during the trip is that the students in Singapore are very independent. Other than learning from textbooks, they also organize overseas trips to interact with the students in a nearby country. Developing the international perspectives is also one of their teaching targets. The experiences not only allow me to be exposed to another culture, but also help me get in touch with the foreigners without fear, which in turn broadened my horizon. Next, my teammate Jasmine will conclude our speech.
Since President Tsai was nominated on May 20th, Safe Belt policy has been a crucial policy for the new government. It aims at building closer economic and even strategic cooperation with Taiwan's neighbors in Southeast Asia. In addition, Taiwan is home to many laborers and immigrants from the region. What's more, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations is Taiwan's second largest trade partner. Therefore, as a citizen of Taiwan, to strengthen the relationships with countries in Southeast Asia is becoming increasingly important. Although we are teenagers, we can interact with people there by being an Asian student, doing voluntary work, or expressing concern about the immigrants from the region. Next time I'm come across them, I think I'll have many things to chat with them. I hope they can feel at home here, just as we were treated in Singapore. Thank you.